turn to page 854. Page 854, Joy Unspeakable. All right, think about what you're singing. All right, show it on your face. 854, standing as we sing.
I have found the praises of God.
Have that trouble there? Or a couple of you. All right. Maybe a couple of you are honest and the rest of it. We're glad you're here tonight. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the day. Thank you for the privilege it's ours to gather in your house this evening. We pray that you would again be with us. And Lord, we're thankful for the blessings we receive here. We pray your blessing on our desire to worship you in song with our offerings. And Lord, help us to be in tune with that which you have for us as your word is preached tonight. Minister to needs, and as only you can, and Lord, help us to respond in obedient faith. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
still stand, turn to page 185. Page 185, Jesus paid it all. Page 185, standing as we sing. That tomorrow is Labor Day, so due to the holiday, the school, no school tomorrow, as well as church offices will be closed tomorrow. This Wednesday is the beginning of our Patch and Peewee Patch program, so if you have a youngster of that age group, you want to make sure they're signed up on the bulletin boards for their Peewee Patch or regular patch program. Make sure they're signed up if you don't have them signed up already. Those programs will begin on Wednesday, and they run in conjunction with our evening service. So they start right at 7 o'clock back in the fellowship hall area. Though if you're not been involved in it before, they'll help direct you where you need to get your kiddos. But you might get here a few minutes early for that, so you're not late for the start of church here in the auditorium. And then remember as well that Thursday will be the ladies' conference work day, work evening. They begin at 3 and get wrapped up about 5 o'clock. In preparation for our ladies' conference that we're hosting this Friday and Saturday. We're excited about that. And the first service kicks off right at 7 o'clock, so you want to get here a little bit early for that, ladies, so you can get your conference material and be ready to go for the first session there on Friday evening. And so Crystal Ellis will be the keynote speaker, as well as we have several workshops that will go on Saturday, so it'll be a full evening. And then first part of the day, their better part of the day on Saturday. So, did we get all the helpers? All right, great. So we've got the guys lined up to help with lunch and moving things around and so on. So that's good. If you have not yet paid your registration, you can see Audrey Todd after the service. She'll be in the foyer. You can get that paid, and hope that again we'll have as many ladies as possible. If you're able to come, I hope that you will. It's not too late to get to squeeze in there and get signed up. See Audrey or my wife about that tonight. I'll get you signed up for that. For ladies involved in the WOW meeting, that's been bumped because of the holiday tomorrow, so that'll be next Monday, September the 12th. And then last but certainly not least, let's be in prayer for, and I hope that if you're able, you'll be here to encourage and support the family, the Taylor family, as we'll be hosting the funeral for Miss Elizabeth Taylor, who went home to be with the Lord just last week. That'll be on Wednesday. There'll be a visitation time from 11:30 to noon, and then the service will be at noon, both of those here at the church. And so I hope you'll be in prayer for the family if you're able to be here. I know that'd be a blessing to them. All right, we'll have our ushers come. We'll receive our offering tonight. Another healthy attendance today. We're grateful for that. We've got some more guests here today, so we praise the Lord. Let's stay at it. Praise the Lord. Good to have everybody here tonight. Even though it's raining, we need the rain, so it's like most of us are even happy that it's raining a little bit because we know we need it. Well, the lawns are turning green again. Of course, that means we got to make sure the mowers still operate. That's how that works. Ethan, you want to ask the Lord's blessing on the offering?
Lord, thank you for this evening for coming together.
Still his time.
2 Chronicles chapter number 14. Well, it's good to be here tonight. Good to be with the Lord's people. I'm going to ask you, if you would, to stand if you're able in honor of the scriptures. And tonight, I'm going to read the whole chapter, or we are going to read the whole chapter. I'd like to start out, and of course, I'll read the first verse and then the second, and we'll complete chapter 14 of 2 Chronicles. Verse number 1. So Abijah slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the city of David. And Asa his son reigned in his stead. In his days the land was quiet 10 years. For he took away the altars of the strange gods in the high places, and break down the images, and cut down the groves.
And commanded Judah to seek the Lord God of their fathers, to do the law and the commandments.
Also he took away out of all the cities of Judah the high places, the images, and the kingdom was quiet before him.
And he built the cities in Judah, for the land had rest.
Therefore he said unto Judah, let us build these cities and make about them walls and towers and gates and bars, while the land is yet before us, because we have sought the Lord our God. We have sought him, and he hath given us rest on every side. So they built and prospered. There came out against them Zareph the Ethiopian with an host of 1,000, 300 chariots, and came unto Maresha. And Asa cried unto the Lord his God, and said, Lord, it is nothing with thee to help, whether with many or with those that have no power to help us. For, O Lord, our God, we rest on thee, and in thy name we go against this multitude. O Lord, thou art our God. Let not man prevail against thee.
So the Lord smote the Ethiopians before Asa, and before Judah, and the Ethiopians fled.
And Asa and the people that were with him pursued them unto Gera, and the Ethiopians were overthrown, and they could not recover themselves, for they were destroyed before the Lord. and before his host, and they carried away very much spoil.
And they stole all cities round about Gera, but the fear of the Lord came upon them, and they spoiled all the cities, for there was exceeding much spoil in them.
And they smote also the tents of the cattle, and carried away sheep and camels in abundance, and returned to Jerusalem. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessing of the Word of God and how it continually teaches us to trust you, to walk with you, and then live in your favor and be blessed by you in so many, many ways. Thank you so much for the songs of this evening and the salvation, the shed blood, so many things that have spoken to our hearts. I pray now that you apply the scripture to our hearts, that we'd listen in the power of the Spirit of God, and that you'd make changes in our lives according to your will. If there's someone here without Christ, may they be saved tonight. We pray in Jesus' name. In all times, but in this time of ours, it's important to keep before us the truth that God changes things. He changes things in our lives, but those changes are based upon our choices. They don't happen automatically. Salvation doesn't happen because we know how to be saved. It happens when we choose to be saved. Living the Christian life is a life of daily choices. And God desires to walk with us in those choices and to bless our lives, make our lives trophies of His grace, that we shine as lights for Him in the world in which we live. As we look at this passage of Scripture, we think, well, how could this help me that happened so many hundred years ago? But the principles of God are unchanging. The way God works in someone's life is the same way He worked in Asa's life. He can work in my life. He can work in your life and desires to do so. The Bible says God is no respecter of persons. What a blessing that is to read the Word of God and make the application to our own hearts. As we look at this passage, it starts out there in verse 1 and it talks about Abijah. And Abijah was the son of Rehoboam. Now let me just kind of back up. When Solomon was king, he was king over all the tribes of Israel. And then you'll know as Rehoboam, his son, became king, he made some poor choices, but the Bible says that God allowed the kingdom to be split, and I believe because of their idolatry, God was judging them. And so Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, and then you have Abijah, the son of Rehoboam. But Abijah was an evil king, and he only reigned 3 years. After him came Asa, and he's the king of the southern kingdom, or the kingdom of Judah, that Rehoboam and Abijah were kings of. And now Asa takes over, and we'll see him prosper because of his choices. You know, that's true of you and I. That's true of our church. We're either going to fail because of our choices or prosper because of our choices. Now, maybe not prospering in the eyes of the world, but it's much better to prosper in the eyes of God. And that isn't just eternally rewarded. I believe it's rewarded greatly in this life. Personally, I believe I've lived long enough to see it. It's a blessing to be right with God and to reap the benefits that only God can give. And so we don't have to, as we look at Abijah and then Asa, we need to realize we don't have to be hindered by the sins of those that have gone before us. You know, we live in this victim age where it's everybody's fault that we're that we do wrong. By the way, if you do wrong, it's no one's fault but yours.
Amen.
Or mine. We don't have to do wrong. We can do right. We're well instructed in the Word of God. If you want to know what God says about it, you can find it, or you can find someone that will help you find it. And so we can do that which is right, and we can live in the blessing of God. I want you to notice that in each one of these points would make, I believe,
a good message, but I'm going to bring three of them. The first one is, and I want to make it a little more personal, but it's your turn. It's your turn. As we look at Asa, realize that it was Asa's time. It was his turn to take over. You know, when we were kids, we used to play a lot of softball, a lot of baseball, and we used to take a bat. I don't know if you ever did this. We take a bat, and we throw it at the other guy, and the guy catches the bat, and then you went. And then when you got to the top, that showed who was up to bat. Well, you're up to bat. It's our turn. It's your turn. It's my turn. You say, oh, preacher, you're too old. Well, that may be, but it's still my turn. God hadn't said it's not my turn anymore. I'm talking to Brother Kirby tonight. Kirby, it's your turn. It's still your turn. Until we're gone, it's our turn. It's not related so much to age as it is to the decisions we make every day for God. And here, for Asa, it was his time. It was his turn. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 6:2, behold, now is the accepted time. And we like to apply that to salvation, and that's, I believe, what it's talking about. Now is the accepted time. But it applies to the Christian life every day. Now is the time. The pastor was talking about witnessing this morning. Now is the time. Well, when I have opportunity, when I have time. No, now is the time. Now is the opportunity. Now's the time to make those right decisions, every day. There are three important things in verse 2, and I want to read that verse again. There are probably more than that, but these three I'd like to point out. And Asa did that which was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. Asa did that which was good and right in the eyes of the Lord, his God. Three things. There are three important things here. First of all, good. We use the word kind of flippantly, don't we? You know, that's a good meal. This is good. That's good. But really, the word good has to do with the character of something or someone. It's not just the thing itself. If you had a You could have a peach. Man, I love peaches. You could have a peach, and it could be a good peach, or it could be running juice down your sleeve because it's so rotten. You'd still have a peach, but the character of the peach would be obvious. It'd either be a good peach, or, of course, some people say if it wasn't from Georgia, it wasn't a good peach. But I'm telling you, there's some other places that have good peaches. I like them all. But the character of something, the fruit of something, the word good, honorable, fair, unblemished. God describes creation there in the book of Genesis, and he finishes creation. He says it is very good. God used the word good there to describe creation before the fall in Genesis 1 and verse 31. Now, so the Bible says Asa did that which was good. We think, well, that's good. But then it says he did that which is right. Wasn't that the same thing? I thought about that. You know, right, something can be right without being good. Huh? Oh, yeah. Something can be right without being good. Well, what do you mean? Well, suppose I said to one of my boys when they were younger, maybe I'll use Caleb since he's not here. Caleb, it's your turn to go out and mow the grass. So Caleb goes out and gets on the mower. I don't have to do this. I got stuff to do. I got important stuff to do, Bob. I don't want to have to do this. It could be right if you mowed the grass, but it wouldn't be good. Are you following me? The character of the thing. And so when the Bible says that Asa did that which was good and right, it's talking both about the character of the thing and it's talking about the thing he actually did. Sometimes we are doing things right, but we're not good. What do you mean? Well, I came to church. That's the right thing, isn't it? Has to be good. Are you following me? Has to be good. And so when the Bible doesn't just throw words out there, oh, it's good and right. No, it was good in its character, and it was right, the things that he did. And so that should be true of our lives. I hear people, well, you know, I'm putting my kids in Christian school, all right? Why? That's the right thing to do. Well, so they won't be out in the world. You need to put them in Christian school as an extension of what you're doing in your home, training them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Amen. See, that's why they should be in Christian school. Well, I don't want to be in all this filth in the world. That's the wrong reason. We say, isn't that a good reason? Not necessarily, because they won't have the character to go along with the right place. Amen, preacher. And it's the character or the good that's going to make the difference. You say, well, I'm protecting them from the world. Good for you. You can protect them all you want. That's not going to save them. They need Christ, and they need Christ in their life, and they need to be godly young people. That's the need of the hour, and that's their need. So, good and right, but here's the third part of this verse, and the most important part. And Asa did that which was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. So you would say that Asa did good, he did right, and he did right in the eyes of the Lord, and then it goes personal, his God. So he did good, right, in the eyes of the Lord. So, preacher, what's the big deal here? Good, right, eyes of the Lord. What? This is the most important part. You see, that was the greatness of Asa. Because he just didn't do good and right as he thought was good and right. He did that which was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. By the way, our country used to be more like that. We've lost our bearings as a country because we've lost the Bible in our country. It's no longer part of our culture. That's where you and I really rise or fall, succeed or fail. The eyes of the Lord. You see, humanism, what is humanism? Simply stated, it's I'm in the place where God is supposed to be in my life. Humanism has replaced the eyes of the Lord with the common good. So man decides what's good for man. Are you following me tonight? It'll only fail. It'll never be blessed of God. Now you say, oh yeah, preacher, that humanism. What about your home? Well, I'm making decisions. You need to give them back to God. You need to live for the Lord. You need to live under the eyes of the Lord. You see, we've become more humanistic than we think. Well, I'm doing right. Why? Who's to say you're right? Well, preacher, this is just your opinion. No, I don't live by my opinion. I live by the Word of God. There's a difference. We know what God says about almost every subject. We're well versed in the Bible. We don't have any excuses. The common good That's how abortion is looked at. Well, it's good for the mother. Huh. What a warped way to look at murder. That sodomy. Well, that's the way God created me. Hogwash. It's just an absolute devil's lie. You give yourself to the lust of the flesh. Wicked. Adultery. Well, you don't understand. You're right. I don't understand that wickedness. You don't understand that wickedness leads to a destruction of your own life. The Bible talks about adultery in the Bible as destroying your own flesh. Wicked. It's wrong. We can't justify those things. Well, you know, everybody's going to do what everybody's going to do. No, they're not. And the sad thing is that's kind of the way of our culture today. Look, we need to realize this business of what's good for me, this is what's good for us. God loves us. He tells us what's good for us. He tells us what's good. He tells us what's right. And we're to live in the eyes of the Lord. What a blessing to know Him. And to have the opportunity, as the boy sang tonight, to live for Him. To live for Christ. Good, right, and in the eyes of the Lord. Then secondly, I want you to notice in verses 3 through 8, and we're not going to read them because of time, but opportunity, verses 3 through 8. Asa's opportunity and your opportunity. You know, one of the things I realize as I do get older, I realize that some of the opportunities I had as a young man, I don't have anymore. I mean, they're past. I can't do that anymore. I can't do this anymore. That opportunity's gone. Now, we ought to take and find the opportunities God has placed before us. And when they're there, take that opportunity and run with it. What do you mean? Well, salvation itself. Salvation's not an opportunity you have forever. And that's what we quoted the verse earlier. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. When you hear the gospel, you and I are to respond. Well, God, not today. I've got some things I want to do. No, you don't put your hand in God's face and say, not today. If He's tugged at your heart, you need to obey His voice and trust Christ as your Savior. You say, oh, preacher, everybody thinks I'm saved. No, it's not what everybody thinks. It's the truth in your own heart. Do you know Christ as your Savior? You've been birthed into the family of God. The opportunity is ours today. And I want you to notice in this opportunity a couple things. I want you to notice, first of all, in verses 3 through 5, this opportunity, he took opportunity to take away. The Bible says he took away. You know, people are being manipulated by unholy things today. Being manipulated by unholy imaginations, by the television set, by movies, by games, by all different kinds of pornography. People are led to think that this is okay, that this is normal. No, normal is a holy life for a Christian. And holy isn't a bad word. It's a good word, and it's a blessed life, and it's life and life. I mean, holiness is a wonderful biblical word. And we don't need all the wickedness of the world to be happy or to have joy in our life. We sang tonight about joy unspeakable and full of glory. We're the only ones that have... Believers are the only ones that have access to that joy that's unspeakable. But listen, it's only when we walk with God. It comes from Him. It's the fruit of the Spirit of God. We don't create it ourselves. We don't come up with it. We don't have a good attitude. And boy, well, you got to have a better attitude. You'll have joy. No, joy comes from my relationship with Him. And then it is joy unspeakable. We can't explain it. We sure enjoy it ourselves. And don't you like being around joyful people? Hello.
Amen.
I mean, joyful people. I mean, it's like somebody, you ever hear that old quartet song when they're laughing? You know, Ticklish Reuben. You ever hear about Ticklish Reuben? Nobody's ever heard that? Yeah, my name was Ticklish Reuben from way down in Vermont. I've been tickled by almost everything. And then the guy starts laughing. And he, ha, 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 and he starts laughing. The whole congregation's laughing about 5 minutes. Why? Because he he's been tickled by everything. It's contagious. Joy is contagious. You want to be around him. I want to be around him.
And that joy that comes from God can't be faked.
And so you'll notice there that Asa's first opportunity was to take away some things. Well, why is that? I don't want to give anything up. You know, there's probably some things in your life that are stealing the good and right things in your life, if you'll be honest. Sometimes you got to take some stuff away. You say, well, that was easy for Asa. All he had, he was king. It was unpopular to take away people's idols and to cut down the groves in the way that they worshiped heathen gods. That was popular in Israel. You think, well, not in Israel. They were God's people. No, they had become idolatrous. And the king said, not anymore. By the way, Dad, how's your home? Well, I just don't want anybody to be upset with me. I guess they don't need you, do they? You're responsible for God. Not just to tell everybody what to do, but to be what everybody needs. Well, that's a big responsibility. You're to be the spiritual man. I'm not going to talk to ladies because I read my wife's outline. She's going to do a good job. But sometimes we need to take things away, and that's hard. You know, we get bad habits. They're hard to break, aren't they? Amen, preacher. Amen. They're hard to break. I mean, you get things in your life that you know aren't pleasing to the Lord, and well, it's not so bad. We start, it's not so bad. That's kind of what happened with idolatry in Israel. It's not so bad. You know, they worship gods like Baal, who was the god of increase. Is it wrong to want more? It can't be. The Bible says we're to enjoy the things we have as God's given us. We're not to be covetous of what other people have. We can enjoy things with them, but not be covetous, not look at their things and say, oh, that's about good. You ever see somebody get a new car and says, must be nice? You got a problem. They would be thankful they got a new car. And if it's a Chevy, really thankful. Had to throw that in. But the Bible says, it's interesting that God's order is always absolutely right because he tore down, but then the Bible says he built. Huh? Yeah, he tore things down, but he also built things. You can't build on a wrong foundation. Sometimes you have to clean things out to make things right. And so he built. By the way, don't make the Christian life a negative. It's not. The Christian life is a positive. You say, well, if I was a Christian, I couldn't do this and I couldn't do that. You know, if you was a Christian, you wouldn't be hooked by all that junk that the world is hooked on. It's destroying their life. You wouldn't be wasting your money on alcohol and drugs and a whole bunch of stuff that destroys life. You'd be investing your life in the things of God and enjoying the fruits and benefits that go with that investment. And so he began to build. You know, God wants to build our life. The Bible says that in the book of Matthew, the wise man built his house upon a rock. That rock is Christ. Built your life on Jesus Christ. Decidedly make that decision. I'm going to build my life on Jesus Christ. You can't go wrong. Why? Because he's the author. And so he built, not a negative, but a positive. The Bible says, oh, taste and see, the Lord is good. And then in verse number 7 there of chapter 14, therefore he said unto Judah, let us build these cities and make about them walls and towers and gates and bars while the land is yet before us. because we have sought the Lord, our God, we have sought him, and he hath given us rest on every side, so they build and prosper. What did he do? He praised the Lord. Look, we've had peace for 10 years. It came from God. God's blessed us. God's given us this peace. Let's do something with it. Well, we have a wonderful church. We really do. I mean, it's amazing. You know, when God saves people, we wouldn't recognize their old life. We think we know people. We don't. We didn't see them before they got saved. Many of them. We think of them as being saved people, as living for Christ. We have a wonderful church. It's wonderful to meet with God's people. It's wonderful to hear the choir sing. It's wonderful to hear the congregation sing. It's wonderful to hear the Word of God preached and to be a part of what God's doing in our time. And we need to continue to build for God. Well, yeah, preacher, we need a new building. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about building our lives up in Christ. And if we properly build, we'll be the witnesses we need to be. We'll have the good and the right in the eyes of the Lord, because we're building for God and we're praising God. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Psalm 150 and verse 6. And then I want you to notice lastly, it's your battle. It's your battle. You say, well, I thought he gave peace. He did. God gave Asa and the people of Judah, he gave them peace for 10 years. And Asa came in, he got rid of the idolatry for the most part. He cut down the groves. He got rid of the many kinds of worship that they had. Much of it was immoral. And he cleaned up the land, and then he began to build the cities and reinforce those cities. He built walls. And why is he building these walls? Because there's an enemy. There's an enemy. But preacher, I'm not having any problem. There's an enemy. He wants to ruin your life. He wants to ruin your life's relationships. He wants to ruin your marriage. He wants to ruin your family. He wants to ruin your friendships. There's an enemy. Say, well, boy, if I'm going to church and I got my kids in Christian school and I'm doing right, everything's going to be rosy. There's an enemy. And he's coming. He's coming for you. The devil goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He wants to destroy your life. So Asa's doing all these good things. The kingdom's doing well. He's building it up. Everything's going forward. I mean, what could be better? He's telling the people, praise the Lord. God's given us peace. Here comes the enemy. And the enemy is overwhelming. 1,000,000. That's 1,000,000 people are coming. Well, how big is Judah's army? Half. He's coming with horses and chariots. It looks like doomsday for Judah. I mean, they're all washed up. They can't fight. Look, we need to realize that we can't fight the enemy alone. It's your battle. It's my battle. It's not someone else's. Well, the pastor needs to deal with it. No, you and I need to deal with the battle. And I don't want to sound spooky, but the devil's coming after you. If he can get you out of the Word of God and get you out of church and get you away from God's people and get you to not live for Christ, he'll do whatever he can do to see that happen, because you become negative. You become outside of the family of God and you won't enjoy your walk with the Lord, and the devil wins. It's our battle. It's your battle. But the question still is decision. It's choice. We know the battle's coming. Isn't it? I mean, something's going to go wrong. Oh, yeah, preacher. You know, Eeyore. Oh, well, might just as well. That's not what I'm talking about. We know the battle's coming. We don't live that way.
Oh, the battle's coming. Oh, maybe today.
Well, that'd be an awful way to live, wouldn't it? And, you know, I hope the wheel doesn't fall out of my car. I hope nobody runs into me today. I hope. Maybe you can live in fear all day. I mean, the sky's falling, Chicken Little. That's not what I'm talking about. But we know the battle's coming. So we know we're going to be in a fight, but we also know that the fight is going to be bigger than us. But preacher, we've done good. We've done right in the eyes of the Lord. So we're going to be what? Blessed. So nothing's going to go wrong. Yes, it is. And by the way, you say, well, I'm going to be all prepared for this. If you're doing what I just said, you're prepared. But the battle's coming. Something's coming out of somewhere. Don't worry about the battle. Live for Christ. But when it comes, the Bible tells us here what to do about it. This is a tremendous passage of Scripture. Notice verse 9 again of chapter 14. And there came out against them Zerah the Ethiopian with an host of 1,000 and 300 chariots, and came to that word I can't pronounce. And I want you to notice Asa was facing a trained army twice its size, 1,000. But there are three wonderful truths here that'll help you and help me. The first one is in verse 11, and let's read that whole verse. And Asa cried unto the Lord his God and said, Lord, see, I can almost see Asa praying. I can almost see him down on his knees with his head bowed. Maybe he's on his face all the way, and he's just saying, Lord, it is nothing with thee to help. Whether with many or with them that have no power. But then he makes it personal. That's what this battle is going to become. At some point in my life and in your life, it has at times. Personal. Help us. You know, when you see someone else going through the battle, you can pray for them. Are you following me? But when it's you and it's yours, you need to turn to the Lord the way Asa did. Help us. O Lord our God, we rest on thee, and in thy name we go against this multitude. O Lord, thou art our God, let no man prevail against thee. I just want to point out three things tonight, and we'll be through. Total dependence. How did he describe with those that have no power? In other words, this is too much for us. You ever been there? It's too much for me. I just can't do it. It's too much. That's a good place to meet with God. Total dependence. This is often where we try to be with God. Lord, I failed. And I can't do this. That's not total dependence. Not my health, not my mental strength, not my character, not my morality, not my faithfulness. No. He started out depending on God. He didn't say, God, I've been faithful, I've done this, I'm doing that. Lord, I need your help. Well, let me just bring this to a how frail a human relationship is, but I've got some of my children here tonight. Let's say Sarah or Sam or Jim said, Dad, I need your help. I'm just a dad. I'm just a parent. Say, well, what would you do? Help. Wouldn't you, Dave? Killed you, you'd help. I wanted to kill them a few times, but if it killed you, I just threw that in. That was free. Are you following me? Well, God loves far beyond that I could fathom, that I could put in words. We don't even have a word big enough to describe the love of God. And God loves you. And what Asa said is, help us. I think God's going to answer that prayer. Then, I want you to notice not only total dependence, but personal relationship. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. He's crying out to his God. He'd already stated that in the earlier passage. His God. Oh, Lord. Personal relationship. Let me ask you tonight, let me just stop there. How's your personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If you said, well, I believe I'm walking with the Lord. Man, that's wonderful. What a wonderful place to walk. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. What a blessing. I love those early chapters in the Bible where Adam's walking with the Lord. You know, they're fellowshipping with God. They're cool of the day, without sin, and what a blessing that Jesus Christ has made that possible for us to fellowship with God. You know, some of the closest times I believe I've had with the Lord have been when we faced things that were too big for us. When you realize God's presence in your life. I want you to notice the last thing here. By faith, Asa put it all on God's shoulders. He said, against thee. What? Against thee. Notice there at the end of the verse. Thou art our God, verse 11. Let not man prevail against thee. He put on God's shoulders. Let me give you the New Testament. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Oh, it's too big for me. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. God's proved he cares. Turn over to the Lord. Too big for you to carry. Too big a battle for you to win. David knew that in 1 Samuel 17:47. The battle is the Lord's. The battle is the Lord's. I want you to notice last and realize we have an enemy. But the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, the last enemy is death. But the Bible doesn't stop there. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin. The strength of sin is the law. But thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We're victorious. You say, well, preacher, you can't beat death. Oh, yes, we can. We're translated from this life into heaven. Twinkling of an eye will be with Christ. Death is already lost to them because of Jesus Christ. Turn it over to him. What a blessing it is. And I want you to notice this one thing, and I'll be through. God's trial will leave you blessed. God allowed the enemy to come against them, didn't he? He allowed them to come in. He allowed them to attack. It was a trial for Asa, but Asa turned to the Lord. Asa said, God, this is your fight. God, help us. We need your help, Lord. And God did help, and God defeated the enemy, but who spoiled the enemy? People of Judah. You know, when you make it through the trial, there's great blessings. I've seen some tremendous blessings in my life. I've seen people who got away from the Lord come back, and I've seen God restore their lives. And what a blessing it is. I mean, to see someone who'd gotten saved, got away from the Lord, they got right with God, and they began to grow again, and in an amazing way, you see them walk with God afresh and anew. That's special. I mean, just a blessing of God. The trial didn't destroy them. They were able, through Jesus Christ, to be blessed. And by the way, that's what God wants to do in my life and your life. He desires not only that we would be a blessing, but we would be a blessing from the resources of His blessing. He wants to bless our lives. He's not walking around waiting with a big stick trying to whack you. He's looking, he's got arms out trying to love you. And what a difference. So as we look at the life of Asa, we begin to see a man who, by the grace of God, decided to do that which was good, right, in the eyes of the Lord. And he had to tear some things down. What about you and me? You know, we get bad habits and we think they're okay. They're not. You know, there's so much wickedness available to us today. It's even hard for kids to be kids anymore. I mean, this is a tough time. I mean, innocence is almost a thing of the past, even with little kids. It's sad. We need God's help. There's some things maybe you and I need to tear out of our life. Say, Lord, I don't believe this pleases you. In other words, that which is right in the eyes of the Lord. Getting right with God in the heart. And then comes a battle. Oh, well, preacher, what do you mean? I did good. I did right. I did it in the eyes of the Lord, and I got some things out of my life, and then comes a battle. Why do you want me to do this? So God can bless you. Well, that doesn't seem like a blessing to me. Oh, it is. You can ask Job. When he really got to know God, God blessed him in amazing ways. I don't know how he did it, but what an amazing man of God he became, and God poured out his rich blessings through the trial. And what a biblical illustration of going through those trials and doing the right thing, how God blessed the life. What about you today? Good? Right? In the eyes of the Lord? Tear some things down? Build some things up? That's how you build right here. Build some things up. Face a battle, find the blessings. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the word of God. How clearly you show us over and over again in the Scripture, not only how we're to live, but how we can really live. Not only how to get by, but how to win. How to enjoy our lives. How to walk with you. I pray tonight, if there's someone here without Christ, that come, give you their heart. Well, the folks need to maybe tear some things down in their life. I pray that they'd come and meet with you. And perhaps some of us are going through the battle. Lord, I pray you minister to that heart. Give them faith. Help them to cast their care upon you. Bless the invitation, I pray in Jesus' name.